beginning in the first place?
Your guess is as good as mine.
That's bizarre.
It very, very much so, you know, and there was, you know, it's interesting because there was a school teacher in Philly that I interviewed as well, and she had a similar thing where she actually had a dream where she was taking her three-year-old son to preschool, but she was running late. And in the dream, as she brought him into the school, she realized that she left her pocketbook on the front seat of her car. You know, so then she reaches her vehicle, and in the dream, she remembers being surprised to find it was still there. But she noticed that her stuff had been torn apart, and her wallet was stolen. Then all of a sudden, she wakes up from her dream. So, ironically enough, she was running late, but she was certainly cutting it close. She's dropping off her son at preschool, basically the same type of dream situation. And as she approached her school then to work, she met another teacher walking up to the door, and all of a sudden, the other teacher looked at this teacher, and she goes, "Oh crap, I left my phone right on the front seat of my car. My car's going to get broken into again." And then this one teacher then shares the dream with her and says, "Hey, you know, don't worry about it. I'll tell them you're running late. Just go get your possessions." That's strange. So it's almost like she had a premonition, and for somebody else as well.
What causes this connection?
Again, I think stress is a key factor in a lot of these experiences. I think that's one element that...
Of both parties? They both have to be under that kind of tension?
That, I don't know 100%, but I know that in a lot of the people who share with me their stories of these inexplicable events, I always ask what their state of mind is before the event, or what they can remember, what they can recall, and how they kind of processed it. And stress is one of those key components. And also, it's strange because... you know, like I mentioned with the Rhea Baker case, there's almost like this strange manipulation factor going on behind the scenes, too. People are acting out of character. They're doing things they wouldn't normally do. And it's not occurring to them as unusual until I bring it up. And I said, "Would you have done that under any other normal circumstances?" And they're like, "Well, wait a minute, no, I wouldn't have. That's really bizarre. Why did I do that?" So,
well, I think what happened in your case with the car situation is... you picked up on the guy who hit that car, and you were picking up his thoughts and, you know, his panic as he's running into the building and everything else. And I think you probably picked that up somehow.
Yeah, that's certainly a possibility. You know, I've had other experiences, too, that are along those lines. And, again, why did I pick up this random stranger's thoughts? You know, that I can't. To figure out
of anybody out there, why him, right?
Yeah, absolutely. And I kind of kick myself nowadays thinking back on it, like I should have talked to that guy, found out what his story was, seeing if maybe our paths had kind of overlapped or crossed at some point. Maybe we had a lot more in common than I would have realized. I don't know.
Fascinating indeed. Doppelgangers, what is your definition of a doppelganger? Yours.
Yeah, well, we all know the classic definition. With doppelgangers relating to what I've been researching, is they seem to be taking on a form that, what should I say, it kind of like, I really don't know. I don't know how to describe it other than like it's like a carbon copy of somebody. But it doesn't necessarily have to be like a full-blown manifestation, right? They're just, it could be like a shadow that looks like them or has the same height and build. I get a lot of those cases. Let me share with you one particular case that really bothers me.
Okay.
This was with a couple in Carrollville, New Jersey named Tina and Eric. And they were on a cruise ship. And... you know, a lot of these cruise ships are very, very small. You know, if somebody wakes up in the middle of the night, you're going to know it because the beds are very close to one another. But what was fascinating about this is Tina and Eric had a remarkable shared experience. What happened was Tina, the mom, she woke up by her son getting out of bed and proceeding to the direction of the bathroom. And she was getting ready to say something when she heard her husband, Eric, call out the boy's name and told him to lay back down in bed. But this boy, he was actually not in the bathroom, but he was still in his own bed, and he answered back, much to both of their confusion and surprise. And when I first heard about this case, I had met them at a wedding, and I thought, okay, this is interesting, but I really want to ask the boy what was going through his mind at the time. So I, you know, found him at the wedding, I talked with him, you know, individually, and I said, hey, what do you remember about that night in particular, besides your dad waking you up? And I asked him if he was dreaming, and he said, yeah, I was. I was dreaming that I was walking to the bathroom, and my dad wakes me up. So what's also fascinating about this is this family has had several other doppelganger experiences with this particular boy.
Isn't a doppelganger supposed to be almost like the exact duplicate of you, except that it's evil?
Yeah, exactly. Like, the classic definition being, you know, evil twin, right? And then if you see it, you're supposed to die. Well, lots of people see these doppelgangers and nobody dies, at least that I'm aware of.
Right.
But it could blow their mind, for sure. And, and with Tina, when she saw, on another occasion, she saw her son's doppelganger, she heard rustling around from the boy's room. She wakes up, she sees the boy walking down the hall, but just a shadow because it's dark. It prompted her to get up out of bed and chase after him, go down the stairs, call out his name, only to find out there's nobody there. So the boy has also had a lot of out-of-body experiences, too. So is it himself, like, inadvertently projecting himself? Maybe a lot of these doppelganger cases are like that, right?
That could be very well. Justin, what's your website for folks?
It is normalparanormal.org.
I like that. Normalparanormal.org. And the book, The Spectrum, is still available. I noticed it's still on Amazon available.
Yeah, it sure is. It's and now it's available at some of your local bookstores, too. It's at Barnes & Noble as well. And there's a really great shop in New Jersey, in Mount Laurel, called On Angel's Wings. They've been the biggest supporter of the book. I highly encourage them if you're in the South Jersey area.
When we come back in a moment with Justin Bamforth, we're going to talk about the multiverse theories, more messages from beyond, Men in Black, and some other strange things with UFOs in just a moment on Coast to Coast AM. Again, his website is normalparanormal.org. The book is called The Spectrum. We will be back in a moment on Coast to Coast AM.
The Coast website is now streamlined for mobile devices. Great news if you're a Coast insider or simply want to enjoy our website on your phone. Visit coasttocoastam.com on your iPhone or Android browser.
Crash and vaccine milestones. I'm Johnny DiAgostini from the KFI 24-hour newsroom. One crew member aboard a Navy helicopter that crashed into the Pacific off San Diego has been rescued. The Navy confirmed late Tuesday night that search efforts continue for the rest of the crew. The chopper attached to the USS Abraham Lincoln went down about 60 miles off the shore while conducting routine flight operations. Governor Newsom is announcing a major milestone in coronavirus vaccinations.
80% of all eligible Californians 12 and older have received at least one dose.
Newsom adds weekly vaccination numbers are skyrocketing.
The state of California now over the last 2 weeks has seen an average over 600,000 doses of vaccine administered.
He says efforts to provide more mobile vaccination sites will continue, as well as reaching minorities and rural residents. Los Angeles Dodgers pitcher Trevor Bauer could be facing a long-term absence from the sport. ESPN reports Bauer could be facing discipline from the MLB, regardless if he's charged with a crime by the L.A. County District Attorney's Office. Bauer is facing allegations that he sexually assaulted a California woman and was under a three-month investigation by the Pasadena Police Department. Under the league's joint domestic violence, sexual assault, and child abuse policy, Bauer could be facing a suspension of at least 1 to 2 years. Bauer was placed on administrative leave on July 2nd and could remain away from the Dodgers for the remainder of the season. Gene Simmons is the latest member of KISS to test positive for COVID-19, joining bandmate Paul Stanley. The band is postponing its next 4 tour dates, expected to return to the road late next week in Southern California. Southland weather from KFI, some clouds today, low 70s at the beaches, mid to high 70s in Metro LA, mid 80s in the Valley, and also mid 80s in the Inland Empire. It's 67 degrees in Anaheim, 81 in Palm Springs, 63 degrees in Simi Valley. Really local from the KFI 24-hour newsroom, I'm Johnny DiAgostini.
Griffith Park, there is a work zone. This is on the 134 westbound from Victory all the way to Bob Hope Drive. Right lane's going to be shut down for road work until 6. Mid-City, we have good news. Earlier crash on the 10 eastbound at Normandy has been cleared from lanes. Your drive is recovering in that area. And in North Hollywood, we have a work zone. This is on the 170 northbound from Burbank Boulevard to Sherman Way. Right lane, that's going to be shut down until 6. Expect slowing in that stretch. KFI and the Sky helps get you there faster. I'm Brian Vann.
Hey, it's Dean Sharp. If you've decided to sell your house, I know it is tempting to just get it listed as is or even take one of those cash out deals. But why sell yourself short when making just the right upgrades will maximize its sale value?
You mean like flipping our own home, Dean? We don't have the expertise or the cash for that.
I know, but my friends at Revive do. Revive knows exactly what to change, what to spend, and where to spend it. They'll manage everything for you and front all the costs. Yes, Revive fronts the cost. They get paid back from escrow, but the profit gained is all yours. How much profit? The average client makes over 200% profit on what Revive invests on their behalf. It's a no-brainer. Reach out to iloverevive.com today and see if your home qualifies. To make the most from the sale of your home, go to iloverevive.com. That's iloverevive.com.
If you're self-employed and have been denied by traditional lenders, listen to me. Equinox Home Financing is the answer for the self-employed. You shouldn't be penalized for being an entrepreneur. Instead of using tax returns, they use personal or business bank statements for income. Conventional lenders cannot do this. Equinox Home Financing can get you qualified for the lowest rates available, and they do fast closing loans in less than 30 days. Call 1-855-LOAN-455. 1-855-LOAN-455. EquinoxHomeFinancing.com.
Licensed by the California Department of Real Estate and the California Department of Financial Oversight, NMLS number 1212805.
Find the employees you need to get your business moving. Sign up with iHeartAdBuilder.com and create a custom radio ad to reach job seekers listening to stations just like this one. Get started today at iHeartAdBuilder.com.
KFI AM 640. More stimulating talk.
But that was once upon a time.
Justin Danforth, as we talk about the paranormal world, to jump on board, share your stories with us as well. ParanormalDig.com, 500 people shy of 116,000 signed up members. People are getting married. Tom got a call a couple weeks ago from somebody that they're thinking of getting married.
But they better come through.
They are going to get married. ParanormalDig.com, that's the statement, but they're not over 60, are they?
They're not, but you know what? For those 60 plus like-minded folks,
we've created paranormalbase.com/seniors. You can go there and find 60-plus people, people that are 60 and over that think like you do. So it's paranormalbase.com and also paranormalbase.com/seniors.
At paranormalbase.com, you meet the most fantastic people.
Hi, I'm Tom.
Hi, I'm Jennifer. What brings you here?
Yeah, I'm here to meet someone who understands me.
How so?
Well, I'm into UFOs, ghosts, aliens, Bigfoot, conspiracy theories, the paranormal, that kind of stuff. But can't seem to find anyone who gets it.
Oh, well, nice to meet you, Tom. I gotta go.
Okay, guess that's not your cup of tea? You sure?
Very. Good luck with that.
I can't meet anyone when I'm out, and I really can't find a website for my unique interest. What do you want to do?
Have you thought about paranormaldate.com?
Paro what dot what?
Who are you? I'm a paranormal matchmaker, and it's paranormaldate.com. It's a website for people looking for people like them. Stuff you like, remember?
Interesting. I'll give it a try.
Well, let's try this again.
Hi, I'm Tom.
Hey, I'm Deb. Your profile on paranormaldate.com looks very interesting. So you really saw a UFO?
Well, yeah. It was so intense, but not as intense as meeting you.
You're an alien chasing flirt, but I kind of like it.
Wow, this paranormaldate.com thing really works.
Maybe ParanormalDate.com is for you. People with an interest in things they hear on George's show find their match daily. So if you're looking for that special someone with an interest in UFOs, ghosts, aliens, Bigfoot, conspiracy theories, and, of course, the paranormal, come to the dating site inspired by George Norrie. It's always free to search, and if you decide to upgrade to our amazing new features, use promo code George for a great discount. ParanormalDate.com. You are not alone.
One of the last things you want to do is run to the grocery store or spend more time and minutes and hours figuring out what's for dinner. HelloFresh takes all the guesswork out of that for you and lets you devote more time to what truly matters, and that's having some fun. HelloFresh delivers everything you need, I need, like 50 weekly menu and market items that are always changing. Quick and easy meals with HelloFresh, worthy of a busy weeknight, including low prep time, 10 to 15 minute recipes, easy cleanup options as well. Pre-portioned and measured ingredients save time, and they're delivered right to you. And dinner's just the beginning, because they've got afternoon treats and all kinds of great things. HelloFresh will also save you some serious money. The meals are over 30% cheaper than the grocery store. And it's family friendly. You can bring the family in and do all the cooking, and the recipe cards are easy to follow. They come in full color. It's really fantastic. Go to HelloFresh.com/George14. Use code George14 to get up to 14 free meals. That's a lot, including free shipping. Again, go to HelloFresh.com/George14. Once you're on that website, use the code George14.
Is now Angie. Whether you need help with routine maintenance or you're planning your dream renovation, Angie connects you with top local pros who can get the job done right. See reviews, compare quotes, and book hundreds of projects. Plus, when you book and pay your Angie, we'll cover your project up to the full purchase price, plus limited damage protection with our happiness guarantee. Check out Angie.com, and for more on the happiness guarantee, go to Angie.com/happiness-guarantee.htm.
We're planning a trip to Spain later this year.
But Spanish is
pretty bad. So we're using Babbel.
Babbel's conversation-based method teaches you real-life words and phrases. And with Babbel's interactive, bite-sized lessons, you'll remember what you learned.
There's no easier way to learn another language.
Ahora hablamos español.
He just said, now we speak Spanish.
Babbel, language for life. Now try Babbel for free. Just go to Babbel.com. That's B-A-B-B-E-L.com.
And welcome back to Coast, George Norrie back with Justin Bamforth as we talk about the paranormal world. You've looked at multiverses. What do you think of that? I have my theory about deja vu, but what are your thoughts on the multiverses, Justin?
Yeah, the multiverse, that's an interesting aspect for sure. You know, what exactly is the multiverse? From what I understand, it's You know, it's like if you make, and those in the science field, you know, please correct me if I'm wrong, but my understanding is, you know, that there are certain choices we make, and when we make a choice or a conscious choice, it creates another you in another reality. And, that other you makes choices, which makes other choices and creates other yous. And I've always wondered if maybe there's overlap, right, from this type of a theory. And maybe what we are seeing as ghosts are nothing more than those other yous or other people in other realms.
That's possible. I've always thought deja vu, that ability to think I've been here before, is that too, that just might be a few seconds out of kilter from another universe that we're matching ourselves in.
Yeah, it's possible. I mean, there's so many different theories we can put on paranormal phenomenon or whatever we want to call it, high strangeness. And it's like every theory is plausible. Every theory does have hold a certain weight. But, you know, sometimes when you hear these experiences, again, I just caution people, don't try to categorize it, don't try to label it, just take it for what it is, write it down, most importantly, you know, log all the points of data and all that, because you never know when something seemingly unimportant will actually be, it will give us a clue or be very relevant to an experience.
How did you get involved investigating Men in Black stories?
Yeah, that seems to be a very popular subject that a lot of people are intrigued by. As much as, you know, I like to think that the typical Men in Black case involves, you know, black-clad individuals, you know, wearing the fedoras and the black suits and the sunglasses and all that.
Yeah.
The fact is, it just doesn't always happen that way. Yes, it can, but what I've found is I've started asking people about, have you ever had any odd encounters with odd individuals? Or people that just, you know, stood out to you as not really normal. In fact, while we were a couple hours ago before the show, I got an email from a gentleman who used to work out at Alcatraz Island.
Oh,
he was talking about one such experience. Where these 17 guys showed up to take a tour of Alcatraz, and they all said that they were from AFOSI. You know, the Air Force Office of Special Investigations.
Mm-hmm.
But what stood out to him is that these individuals didn't say anything. They were just very robotic. And they were covered with bruises. And that is what stood out to them, or stood out to this gentleman. And he said, there were no jokes, no talking, nothing. And, if you're looking for classic Men in Black, you're probably going to overlook some of these things. I think they're showing up. They're just presumably normal people, but they're trying too hard to fit in, so it's coming across as very unnormal.
Who do you think they are, or what are they?
Well, you know, this is a great question because my friend Daryl Sims, who is a pioneer in the alien abduction field, you know, I've asked him about this too, because I know he's done some research on this. He's had direct encounters as well with some of his abductees, but he thinks that there are two different types of groups of MIB, and I tend to agree. There's obviously the classic people from some alphabet soup government agency that's, you know, off the book, and that would explain some of the more human encounters. However, there are some experiences that kind of defy that, and, these individuals display very inhuman characteristics. Sometimes they'll just show up out of nowhere. They'll just disappear. How do you do that? I don't know. But sometimes in these really strange encounters, the individuals, they will almost like look, again, not quite right, like they're trying too hard to fit in. Sometimes they don't have any hair, or even pores on their skin. It's really bizarre stuff. Or like this gentleman who emailed me about Alcatraz, they'll seem very robotic. However, there is one common mannerism I've noticed with these individuals. It's their movement. The way that they move is very mechanical, very stilted, or very like somebody described it to me as very like herky-jerky.
Like an android?
Kind of, but like almost like somebody who, I don't know, has trouble or difficulty walking. And now I want to caution your listeners, That doesn't mean every single person you see out there who just looks a little off or may even have a physical disability is one of these odd individuals I'm talking about.
Right.
But there are certain things, certain aspects. For example, there was a lady from New Zealand who emailed me. She had contacted me about something else unrelated to men in black. Well, 2 days, I think it was 2 or 3 days after she emailed me, she was out with her son jogging. And, taking the dog out for a walk. And it's the same park that they go to all the time. And, nothing was unusual. And then she noticed that there were two individuals that stood extremely close to one another, off in the distance. But the motion of their arms and legs did not match the speed that they were jogging in reality. And she said that their heads didn't bob up and down like normally they should do. Not to mention that each time she and her son stopped walking, these two joggers would suddenly stop advancing forward. It was like they were matching their speed or their movement. And the whole experience, it really shook her up. And then she mentioned something to her son about it, and her son said, oh yeah, there was another couple of joggers who were doing the exact same thing a few moments prior to that. Yeah, it freaked her out. And it really bothered her son. And then a couple days after that, they described that they had this dark cloud over their whole house and just overwhelming senses of fear and dread. And she was almost going to completely call off the interview with me. She was waiting for me for this exchange.
Wow.
So, but again, what is that? Typically these men in black or MIB experiences, I just call them, strange people experiences.
Well, initially we thought, Justin, that they were government officials trying to scare people or get them to, not talk about UFO encounters and things like that. It seems to have expanded into where these may be dimensional or ETs.
Yeah, all these theories definitely hold weight. But, the phenomenon operates in such a manner that just when you think you put your finger on it and you figured it out, there'll be another experience or another report that'll come through that completely does the opposite of that. And it's like, well, that doesn't hold up in this case. What is this sort of stuff? And it doesn't just trail UFO experience either. It can trail any sort of experience.
What stories have you covered with strange things from the other side?
Well, that's like things from beyond, like the afterlife, if you will. Well, there was an interesting experience that was sent to me. Actually, it's the same couple, Tina and Eric, who had the weird doppelganger experience with their son. Well, about a month ago, Tina's mother had passed, and she had told her husband that a few months back she had a dream where she saw her mother in a dream. It was in May, and her mother, Geraldine, said very specifically to her, you have 40 days. Now, Tina didn't know exactly what that meant, but she wrote it down on the calendar anyway, in case there was some significance later on. Well, day 40 came and went. Nothing significant had taken place. But in the week since her mother's passing, Tina went to Target on two occasions to pay for items, and she was just randomly handed $40 in cash at the register. But the thing is, she didn't ever recall hitting the cash back option on either instance. And this happened twice. She still received the $40, nevertheless, and when she returned a third time to return some other items, the cashier recognized her and, said something to the notion of, like, I hope that same strange thing doesn't happen with the $40. Then her husband, Eric, was out walking, and he saw a random magnet on a vehicle, and it said, it was an anti-abortion sticker, but it said 40 days for life, and he felt it had some meaning, so he took a picture of it. Tina suggested that Eric share all this with me at some point, and I'm glad he did, because I'm fascinated by these messages, but again, I try to approach it from a different angle, and suddenly a thought popped in my head. What if Geraldine meant 40 business days instead of 40 regular days? Because the two of them, Tina and Eric, they're very, they're business professionals, and they operate on that type of schedule. Once I did the math, I realized that it put the date at exactly, like when Geraldine passed, that 40 business days was exactly the night that she passed. And I'm willing to bet that Tina had that dream at exactly the right, or the exact same hour, too. So, and what's also fascinating is Tina has had an ability in the past to know the exact dates and times of when other people in her family would pass. That's another story, but it really freaked her out.
Wow. So you've got a story about the late actor Telly Savalas, who had a very strange encounter in the New York area, I believe.
Yeah, absolutely. Up in Long Island, New York. This was in the late 1950s. You know, Telly, unfortunately, he is no longer with us, and I really wish I had the opportunity to ask him about some of these experiences, right? Because I think there's more to it than that, or than this, rather. So, short story, he ran out of gas. He made a trek to the nearest business to find out where the nearest gas station was, and as he's making his trek through the woods, he often hears a high-pitched voice say, "I'll give you a ride."
Out of nowhere. Out of nowhere. Yeah.
Exactly. Yep. Just out of nowhere. And when he looked up to see where the voice was coming from, there's a man dressed in all white waiting for him in a Cadillac. And again, wearing all white suits. It's almost like a man in white. Savalas says, again, he never heard the vehicle approaching when all of a sudden it was just there. Either way, he agrees. He gets in a car with the gentleman. They drive off toward the gas station together. Once they arrived, the man suddenly offered Savalas a dollar. Even though Savalas had never asked for any money, he still put the man up on the offer.
For gas, I guess, right?
Exactly, yeah. He didn't have any cash, and he was really embarrassed by it, too, because he did have a full-time job. So what he said...
And this is before he was the actor, right?
Yeah. It's the late 1950s. He worked for the State Department at that time. So he promised to mail the man back his money. You know, just give me your name and, you know, address or phone number, you know, and I'll get it to you. Anyway, so the guy helps him out, puts gas, helps him fill up the container, helps him get it started. Then the man randomly explains, "I know Harry Adonis, who was a baseball player back then." What was odd about it is they weren't talking about baseball. It just popped up. Yeah, the man asked it. And Savalas then said, "Okay, well, who is he?" The guy goes, "A utility infielder for the Boston Red Sox." Okay, strange. Anyway, the night is done. He gets his car started. Anyway, it's the following day. After work, Savalas sees a headline in the Journal American, which read, "Harry Adonis Dead."
Wow.
Right. It gets stranger. So then he thinks back of that guy, that man in white. He sees, you know, his name. He's at the man's name is James Cullen, and there's an address and a phone number. So he calls the number. They answer. They say, "Oh, it's Jimmy Barr." The boss goes, "Okay, can I speak to Mr. Cullen?" Staff is confused. They bring somebody else on the line. This woman answers. And Savalas is like, "Hey, I'm just wondering when I can expect him, because, you know, he lent me some money last night. I want to pay him back." And the woman's really angry, and she's like, "Look, I don't know who you're talking about, but you're talking about my husband, and he's been dead for over 2 years." Hangs up. Yeah. So then Savalas and this woman, they get together, they meet up, they compare the signature, it matches. The description Savalas gives her of how he was dressed was exactly what he was buried in.
Did he have a Cadillac?
No, that wasn't brought up. But what was interesting was the high-pitched voice was brought up, and the woman said, "Well, actually, Telly, he has the same type of deep voice as you, but he killed himself with a gunshot to the throat, right through the voice."
Oh, my God.
Right. So, again, very, very strange. Well, about within 1963, November 1963, Telly Savalas is on the golf course with his buddy, and he hears the exact same high-pitched voice again. And the voice says, "Telly, did you hear what happened in Dallas?" And Savalas looks around at his friends, and he's like, "Did you hear that?" And they're like, "Yeah, we heard it, but we didn't understand what it said." And Savalas is really shaken up. They play a few more holes. He's still bothered by this. So they take a break. They go into the golf club. They're watching TV. Walter Cronkite suddenly interrupts the broadcast.
Kennedy announcement. Oh, my God.
Yep, Kennedy had just been shot. And what was interesting is Savalas, he projected that the time he heard the ghostly voice on top of the hill was about 90 minutes prior to when JFK had been shot. So, or I'm sorry, no, it was, he heard the voice, he heard the broadcast 90 minutes after, but when that time was that he heard the voice, that would have been the exact time that JFK was shot.
Unbelievable. He, and this is a story he took with him to the grave, isn't it? He believed something weird happened to him.
He did, and he also said, again, on an Australian TV show where he was talking about this experience, he said that there were other encounters that he had had with this voice. I reached out to one of his daughters, Ariana Savalas, but she said she didn't hear anything else about it beyond what I knew already.
But she knew about something.
Yeah, maybe. You know, if anyone in the audience knew Terry personally or ever heard directly from him about these other experiences, I'd love to talk with you more about it.
That would be great. Justin, we're going to take a break. We're going to come back and take phone calls with you next. Plus, we'll talk more about some of the UFO stories you've investigated and what you think about the June 25th report from the government. We'll be back.
Find out more about tonight's guest. Log on to coasttocoastam.com.
By working on a steak at Cielo, a wall brewski at Wahlburgers, and my pan at the Oasis Pool. And now, the top five reasons to visit Morongo. Number five.
Legendary beach boy Brian Wilson, live September 16th. This event will sell out. Get your tickets now.
Number four.
Sapphire September giveaway. Get a 9.5-inch fry pan when you earn 500 points on your rewards card. The 6th and 7th.
Three.
Labor Day dining deal. Our shrimp tacos are huge on tape. Only $3.50 at Fiesta Taco. Labor Day weekend.
Number two.
Battle for the gold. You can win up to $2,000 cash playing games with your rewards card. Friday, 6 p.m. to 2 a.m.
And the number one reason.
A Labor Day freebie. Rewards members get a Morongo spatula while supplies last.
Morongo Casino Resort and Spa. Morongo. Good time.
Hey, it's Dean Sharp. If you've decided to sell your house, I know it is tempting to just get it listed as is or even take one of those cash-out deals. But why sell yourself short when making just the right upgrades will maximize its sale value?
You mean like flipping our own home, Dean? We don't have the expertise or the cash for that.
I know, but my friends at Revive do. Revive knows exactly what to change, what to spend, and where to spend it. They'll manage everything for you and front all the costs. Yes, Revive fronts the cost. They get paid back from escrow, but the profit gained is all yours. How much profit? The average client makes over 200% profit on what Revive invests on their behalf. It's a no-brainer. Reach out to iloverevive.com today and see if your home qualifies. To make the most from the sale of your home, go to iloverevive.com. That's iloverevive.com.
Perfect for achy, indecisive minds. KFI's cooling info gel quickly relieves ignorance and leaves a milky fresh scent. KFI and KOST HD2, Los Angeles, Orange County.
It's time for your morning wake-up call. And now, here's Jennifer Jones-Lee.
Hello and welcome to September. The first day of September already. Don't forget, pay your rent, pay your mortgage, all that good stuff. It's also my birthday month, which my dad has teased me since I was a little kid. He said, most people just have a birthday. You celebrate the entire month of September. And I said, oh, why let a whole month go to waste, Dad? I mean, it's way later in the month, but who cares? Welcome to it. It's September, and here's what's happening on your wake-up call.
Yellow County Board of Supervisors says it'll come up with a plan to provide more services for returning military service members and Afghan refugees. The fire burning in the Sierra Nevada in Northern California is moving in on Lake Tahoe. And I didn't even think about this, but Lake Tahoe, that basin is surrounded by ski resorts. And those ski resorts can actually help in the firefight, and I'll tell you how in a minute. And the CDC has added 7 more destinations to its very high COVID-19 travel risk list. I'll tell you what some of the new locations include. And at 5:05, we'll talk with ABC's Connor Finnegan. Connor interviewed one of the officials from the State Department who had volunteered to go to Kabul to help get evacuees out. And this story, it's violent, it's heartbreaking. Connor can explain what the State Department official told him. I mean, it's just stories of people waiting at the airport under constant gunfire. Imagine you and your kids waiting at the gates of an airport to try and get out, and all you're hearing is just booms and blasts and gunshots. So Connor will have that story coming up in just a few minutes. So let's start with some of these stories coming out of the KFI 24-hour newsroom. An Afghan refugee in Garden Grove says his family's being killed one by one because he worked as a translator for U.S. forces.
Please help us.
For safety, the man only wants to be identified as Ahmadi. He says he was shot 3 times but escaped almost 5 years ago, leaving 9 family members behind.
His 20 years in American war in my country, our country got more progress. And now when Taliban came, everything finished. They have a complete list for each person.
He says the Taliban is going house to house checking that list for anyone who helped America.
They take the people out and they kill one by one. Each day, 2 target killings, 3 target killings, they do.
Mahdi says in July, men on motorcycles shot and killed his father because they were looking for him.
Each day, because I miss him and I have his graveyard pictures, his everything I have in my phone. Every time, but I don't have nothing. I keep my phone. Swear to God. I can see his picture.
In Garden Grove, Corbin Carson, KFI News.
The LA County Board of Supervisors says it will come up with a plan to provide more services for returning military service members and Afghan refugees.